ability to try and get it right. I think there's a lot of people in the profession who don't necessarily really think that much about who's going to be reading and who's going to be watching. One thing from The Land Is Ours that I picked up was this incredible injustice that we've got historically. And it's one of the reasons why when we're thinking about visions for the future, we've got to be absolutely clear about how we got to where we are now and really kind of disentangle some of the assumptions that we make about the way we live today. Because we do it very wrong, as we all keep hearing. I mean, we've got the social crisis going on, particularly in Britain now, with the gap between rich and poor widening so fast. We've got the climate crisis, and we've got one thing that we didn't hear just now, but really important, is a military crisis going on, particularly in the Middle East, where there's all these tension building up in places like Libya. We've got a terrible situation that we have put together in Iraq. And actually, Syria looks really a very interesting battle, because now the British military are going to the politicians in this country and saying, no way, Jose. Syria is not going to work like Iraq, like Libya worked, for example. And so that's hit the buffers to a certain extent. The way these crises all pan out is going to be very, very interesting. The fact I got from The Land Is Ours, really, was that we have, as many people here know, this is like teaching your grandmother to suck eggs to a certain extent, is we have had the land stolen from under our feet. The thing we need to live has been taken from us historically through enclosures. 350 years ago, we had a civil war. And in this country, if you can believe it, looking at the power of the monarchy today, Prince Charles's immunity from the Freedom of Information Act and him vetoing laws and all this kind of thing. So what happened there was, it was a battle between the feudal classes and the merchant classes, the up-and-coming capitalist class that had made money. And supposedly, the merchant classes won the Civil War. As part of that, they got their a pat on the back. And then they started doing this very, very lucrative thing, which was enclosure. Basically, it was the parliamentarians, because, of course, only landowners ever could even vote in those days, were voting themselves the land. So they were saying, those people over there, we're going to evict them, and we're taking over the control of the land. So we've got 60... But just one fact to bear in mind. We've got about 65 million acres of land in the UK, and we've got also about 65 million people. So my question is, where's my acre? Where's my acre? Now, it's out there somewhere. Of course, you've got massive, massive landowners, who, some of whom, like the Duke of Westminster, or Duke of Argyll, these people, who actually never see vast thousands of acres of the land they own. They never actually ever see it in their entire life. And so this, I think, has got to underpin a lot of our thinking about how to put the world right. Now, we all know it's wrong, and in fact, it's quite boring hearing again and again how wrong it is. The thing is to get a cohesive vision together and a bit of a united front across politics and journalism for a better future. So the title of the talk, George Orwell quote, in an age of universal deceit, telling the truth is a revolutionary act. Well, I think that we're there. I really think we're there right now. There is no investigative journalism going on in Britain of any really important extent. It's dead. When a big event happens that needs a proper examination, it never happens. It really doesn't happen anymore. I just want to run through some from the pre-1990s. Basically, we had something called on ITV called World in Action. We had another ITV program called This Week, which made a program called Death on the Rock, which actually was broadcast within just about a week of an assassination, an execution by the SAS of some IRA terrorists. So the idea being that, yes, there's a war going on in Northern Ireland, but what you don't do is you execute the terrorists. You arrest them, you put them on trial, and you put them in jail. That's what a civilized society should do. But that didn't happen in Gibraltar. I just find it incredible that such an important and massive news event, and as this execution in Gibraltar of these IRA terrorists, could, within a week, produce a documentary which actually pulled the whole thing apart for us. As a result, Thames TV then lost their franchise to broadcast. So you can see there's a constant war going on against these investigative journalists. That's just a couple. We also had Weekend World, if anyone remembers that, with Brian Walden, who was a very, very tough interviewer. And actually, he'd done a lot of research before he got someone in there. So they were scared to death, these politicians, of going in to be interviewed by Brian Walden. That kind of stuff doesn't happen anymore. They also had a lot of one-off series on ITV and BBC. One which I particularly remember is one on the BBC called Secret Society, which was, I think, five-six-part series by Duncan Campbell, the investigative journalist, who was one of the people who was originally put on trial for mentioning the fact that GCHQ existed. Now, that's, we have come away since then, haven't we? You imagine that. He actually wrote an article where he talked about the existence of GCHQ in Cheltenham over the river, and he was arrested for it. He went on trial with several others, including Crispin Aubrey, who died recently, who was helping with the Stop Hinckley campaign on the ABC trial. So that was a different world. Those sorts of investigations were going on, and I just think it's... Does anyone else have any of their investigative programs that they used to watch back in, I suppose, we're talking about 70s and 80s, that don't exist today? Because I think, you know, it's important to remember these things. We've almost forgotten that we don't have this anymore. Anyone like to contribute one? Well, one which we haven't mentioned was actually the most popular television program, current affairs program ever. And he used to pull in an audience of 10 million viewers a week into ITV, Central Television. We're talking about Roger Cook and the Cook Report. Now, a lot of us, you know, whatever happened to Roger Cook? Well, I'll tell you what happened to Roger Cook. And I was very privileged to meet him last year, is his program was torpedoed by Rupert Murdoch and the News of the World. In 2000, there were 4 weeks of double-page spreads in the News of the World. Roger Cook's made it all up. Roger Cook fakes his footage. Roger Cook bribes people to say things on his TV show. And after 4 weeks of these lies that have been printed by Murdoch's News of the World, ITV came to Roger Cook and said, look, we're going to have to pull the program. We can't carry on until this legal battle between you and the News of the World is finished. That was in 2000. And the stuff that Roger was doing at the time is really, I find, incredible. He did, for example, a program about the poor security at US airports in the run-up to the 2001 9/11 attacks. Where they managed to smuggle through all sorts of things onto planes, get people onto planes that didn't have tickets. And this happened at Boston Logan Airport, which was one of the main airports where the hijackers got on the 9/11 planes. So Roger was almost kind of seeing a year into the future to the 9/11 attacks and warning people. Another program he did was infiltrating the National Front, the truth behind the front, where he did, I think it was over 2 weeks, he had Nick Griffin on tape saying all sorts of things that he would never ever say in public and never say it on Question Time, but making it quite clear that they had to put this front out to the public of a reasonable organisation where actually they were hardcore racists in the middle. And he managed, Roger managed to record quite a lot of them making these racist statements with hidden cameras. So there was a lot. There was another one. For example, nuclear material being traded on the black market. He went over to do a program about arms dealing. And one of the places at the time where there was a lot of arms dealing going on, because it was a kind of former Soviet Union in transition, was around Moscow. And he managed to find some arms dealers to get some mortar bombs, grenades, and rockets off of, rocket-propelled grenades. And he was filming it all secretly. And whilst it was on film, these guys say, well, are you interested in nuclear weapons? And he actually recorded them on film saying this. Are you interested in nuclear weapons? Anyway, they went back to the hotel, he was explaining to us, and it's in his book, Dangerous Ground. And then they looked at all the tapes, and for some reason, one of the microphones hadn't been switched on. So they'd been hoping to go back and finish the program. So they had to go back one more time. And when they went back one more time to see these arms dealers undercover, they actually took them around the back and they showed them an SS-20 missile, which is a multiple re-entry vehicle, thermonuclear weapons, 500 kiloton to 800 kiloton warheads, and they were prepared to sell Roger Cook one of these. And they lifted up the tarpaulins. Now, this is the kind of stuff he was doing, and it just gives you an idea. When they're talking about Iran, for example, may get nuclear weapons. Well, if these things were available on the black market back in the late 1990s, as the former Soviet Union was in a state of collapse, and many of the people who are in charge of these weapons hadn't been paid for 6 months or a year, what's the chance that potentially the Iranians got hold of some of those nukes back then? They might not need to be manufacturing them. So anyway, this gives us an interesting insight, I think, into the world we really live in. The other thing is that Roger Cook's archive of the Cook Report was all destroyed in a fire. So if anyone's got any old tapes, VHS tapes in your loft of an old Cook Report, find someone who with a bit of technical expertise and put it up onto YouTube, because the DVD of Roger Cook's old programs is never going to come out, because all the archive was destroyed by a company who was supposed to look after it called Iron Mountain at their data center in a fire. So where are we at now? I would say we're at a situation now where it's normal for there to be no investigation. Now, that just doesn't mean investigative journalism, which is quite expensive to do. It also means no police investigation, quite often, at the highest levels. There's a culture of impunity out there, as we might have noticed. How many people have noticed this business of this mis-selling, the use of this word mis-selling, over the scandal to do with the payment protection insurance, the PPI scandal, and interest rate swaps? These are scandals which have been going on and on and on, but they're called mis-selling, the mis-selling of payment protection insurance, the mis-selling of interest rate swaps for people who are getting loans off the banks. Now, this is a complete misnomer. This is not mis-selling at all. This is fraud. It's called fraud. It's under the Fraud Act or the Theft Act. Anyone that does that can be prosecuted. But they call it mis-selling, because there's a culture of impunity now that we can't prosecute these people, the bankers and the traders who are responsible for these things, because it would be too embarrassing for the city. LIBOR, exactly the same thing has happened with there. Now, they have actually called that fraud, but none of the people who are actually doing this LIBOR fraud have actually been properly prosecuted, have they? There's one guy, a guy called Tom Hayes in London, who was started at the Royal Bank of Scotland. He went to another bank and another bank. I think it was a UBS and then Citigroup banks, and he was being poached by one bank and another bank and another bank because he was so good at LIBOR fraud. And the idea that these banks didn't know, or the people weren't culpable, that they were buying the world LIBOR fraud expert in, is shown by the fact that when he went into UBS from the Royal Bank of Scotland, he got a one-off payment, a signing fee, which I quite like if I was to get a job tomorrow. This isn't part of his wages. This is the money he got just for accepting the job at UBS, was £3 million in his bank account as a signing fee for the job. So there is a mass of fraud out there. And the idea that there is any kind of proper investigative journalism into this, well, I haven't seen Dispatches look at Tom Hayes' case and the LIBOR, nor the payment protection. And the fact of the matter is that the lack of prosecutions of all these banksters goes absolutely in line with the lack of investigative journalism in actually looking at who these specific criminals are. And they're getting away with it. It's almost like the kudos that the bully at school gets from getting away with it. So the banksters have got away with it. And so, in a way, what it does is it starts a drive to the bottom. And that's what we're seeing in Britain over the last, I suppose, 10 years or so, is those that have got away with it are making more money than those that actually obey the law. So it drives down the standards right the way across the city. Now, there's a guy who I interviewed on our radio show in Bristol. Actually, funny enough, looking across the river there, you could probably pick us up on FM on a Friday afternoon. You might have been able to pick us up yesterday. But Rowan Bosworth Davis was on the phone on our show a few weeks ago, and he's a former fraud squad detective, 12 years in London. And he has submitted he wrote a report. He's now an academic. He wrote a report for Andrew Tyree's Banking Commission, explaining, looking through all the definitions of organised crime, and and then comparing them to all of what the city banks are doing today. So he's saying basically that all these city institutions, Barclays, Royal Bank of Scotland, are organised crime. And it actually lines up with the European definition of organised crime, the British definition, the US definition. And so that's what we're dealing with. It's a mafia state. And it's run, of course, through the city, which is doing massive amounts of money laundering. Now, the Mexican drug cartels are not particularly nice people. If one of the villages, and there was a thing in The Independent last week about this, I think it might have been Thursday, about villages that try and stand up to these Mexican drug cartels, what they do is they come in, they massacre people at random, and they leave a pile of bodies on the edge of the village so that people don't mess with the drug cartel. Now, who is it that's in charge of HSBC whilst they were doing that money laundering for, and they may still be, who knows, for the Mexican drug cartels? It was Lord Green, who's a minister in the cabinet. Lord Green, who's so behind fracking. So we've got, you can only call it a mafia state. They were running cash around. His bank was running cash around for these Mexican drug cartels in their armoured vans. They even had, in Mexico, 10 or 12 different banks adapted so they could accept suitcases for the cashiers. And then they could take the suitcases in and put them in the little machines and count them. This is good old HSBC for you, and good old Lord Green, and his interest in fracking. So you've got a criminal state, a mafia state. You want to ask your questions? Yeah. So this is a green light for all the other banks to do the same. Honest banks, I've got an account at the Co-op Bank, you know. And what's happening to the Co-op Bank? It's in all sorts of trouble. The sharks are after it, you know. And also, if the other high street banks like HSBC are taking drug cartels cash, then how on earth is the Co-op Bank going to compete with that? You know, this is the trouble. It's a drive to the bottom. Now, it's not new, this sort of problem with a lack of proper investigative journalism, because there's a tremendous amount of disinformation out there. And a lot of publishers over the years have done black propaganda. They'll commission somebody that doesn't know anything about a subject to write a book about it, just so they can say there's a book there. And then if, say, somebody like me that does know about something goes to a publisher, they say, oh, well, someone else has just published a book on that topic. So that's how black propaganda often works, is you'll find on some subjects there's loads of books out there, and only one of them is actually telling you anything that you really need to know about that specific topic. I've often found that. I'll just go through, for example, a very well-known massive scandal, which was in the 1880s, which is the Jack the Ripper scandal. Would anyone here like to hazard a guess, in a nutshell, what was that was all about? What happened? There was, I think it was four prostitutes were found dead, hideously mutilated in London, and it was a massive scandal. But what was behind it? Anyone? Absolutely brilliant. Thank you very much. It was. And it does make you wonder about our modern royal family, if that was what they were doing back in those days. There's a very good book by Stephen Knight, which he wrote in the 1980s, called Jack the Ripper, The Final Solution. Actually, no, sorry, the 1970s. He then went on in the 1980s to write a book called The Brotherhood, which is really like the Bible on the Freemasons and the Masonic, all these kind of Masonic conspiracies. He was looking at Jack the Ripper, and this gave him an in to a lot of people who were quite good on Freemasonry. And so he then started looking at Freemasonry. Isn't that another... When was the last time anyone here saw a TV documentary on the Masons? It's like taboo, isn't it? It's like we're in the South Sea Islands dancing around, you know. We've got a taboo about Masons. We're not allowed to talk about them. Yeah? Of course, Freemasonry, there are quite a lot. The Masonic Lodge, for example, in Bristol, at the bottom of Park Street, I went in there a few years ago to take some photographs, and it has there's a massive thread online about that with some photos inside their Masonic temples and stuff. And in there, I met a chap who was trying to recruit me and everything, and I said, oh, well, I'm a journalist. I don't really think that, you know, this is the sort of thing for me. He said, oh, yes, it is. We've got lots of members at the BBC. Ooh, okay. And so my next question was, well, how do I spot them then? You've got to be, you know, fairly quick with these people. And he said, oh, they wear a little enamel badge on their lapel like this. Yeah. And sure enough, you know, you can see some of the people up at the BBC did have these little things on, you know, so maybe not this time of year when they're only wearing a shirt, but if they've got a suit on, a little enamel badge, little giveaway, a little forget-me-not, you know, this kind of thing. So there are little code words that these organisations use. Getting back to the Jack the Ripper thing, though, and I think it is important. We often hear, we will never know why this happened. Things like 9/11, we will never know the ins and outs of what happened. The 7/7 London bombings, we will never know. Actually, rubbish. If you take the trouble to go and have a look, you will find out. And for anybody that's interested in this kind of teasing out these sorts of issues, which I find fascinating, there's a fantastic book, really a Bible for this, called Secrets and Lies, which is a sort of nice kind of coffee table book, but every single page has got another conspiracy every page, which he gives you, David Southwell, the author, who lives in London on a barge. He gives you enough information in each thing, in each conspiracy, to go and do the research that he's done to get to the bottom of what's behind it. And I think he does a great job, really, in looking at some of the things which we're told there's this massive miasma of things that we will never know about, we will never understand. Well, he just gives you the few little clues you need to satisfy yourself. Crop circles is one, for example. You know, quite clearly, there are not aliens making crop circles. I'm sorry to burst anybody's bubble here, but you know, there ain't no aliens making those crop circles. They're made by people having fun, and who like to see their crop circles on the front page of the Sun. And you know, that's just a fact you're going to have to live with, I'm afraid. You know. So anyway, if you don't believe that, have a little look at David's book and see the evidence that he presents. So it's David Southwell, Secrets and Lies. Very interesting way of actually teasing out a lot of these issues. So yeah, going back to the Jack the Ripper, yes, it was young Edward the VII. He was 20 in 1884, and for whatever reason, the royal family decided he had to get a bit of sexual experience, and he had a child with a prostitute called Annie Crook. And one of the witnesses, Mary Kelly, then started to, with some other prostitutes at the time, decided to try and blackmail the royal family and say, well, we know all about this. We're going to go and publish this information and talk to journalists, etc. And they obviously decided at the highest level in the royals that this was never going to happen. And they made sure they identified everyone that knew about it and murdered them one by one. I wouldn't like to say this is absolutely the definitive answer, but it certainly seems to me by far the best evidenced explanation as to what happened with that particular story. So what about today? What sort of investigative documentaries and books would it be good to see today? Well, what about, for example, what's happened with the Liberal Democrats in this country? They've got elected to do one thing. They've done loads of things which are completely different. They're not, as we just heard, a Democratic Party, actually. They make decisions on the hoof at the top. If the Snoopers Charter is voted against by the full membership of the Lib Dems, oh, it's just overturned by the leadership. But the most important thing is, what have the Lib Dems actually achieved of their aims by being in the coalition? And if you look at that and compare it to what the Irish MPs, and I don't know how well people are versed in the history of the Irish struggle, but back in the 1880s, there were a whole load of Irish MPs, because Ireland sent MPs to Westminster back in those days, to Westminster. And the thing is, the Whigs and the Tories were almost equal, two equal parties. Now, what those Irish MPs managed to squeeze out of the ruling party in order to get their support was absolutely incredible. And it meant that, certainly with regards to Irish policy, they completely ran everything to do with Irish policy. Because the ruling party knew, as soon as we don't do what these Irish MPs say, they're going to be over to the other side. And they're going to be, And so what they did is they managed to get an incredible, powerful land reform going in Ireland, which meant that the government were giving to all these really, I mean, many people who'd come through the famine, families still alive, that had come through that, with rack-renting landlords, they managed to get cheap loans from the government, very cheap long-term loans, talking about 1-2% interest, to buy their own land and to build a new home on it. Right, so that's what they managed to achieve. Whereas the Lib Dems have got, it seems to me, virtually zero from this particular government, from the Tories in the coalition that they've gone into. Nothing. So I would like to see a documentary which looks at, you know, what have the Lib Dems achieved, and I think then they would get even less votes at the next election than they already are going to get, which is probably not a lot. But what this meant was that the repayments on this loan that the Irish former peasants, now landowners, got, was actually far less than their old rent had been, that they'd have been having to pay to the old landlords, the English absentee landlords. So it completely transformed Ireland from a place where there was loads of peasant farming and massive poverty to a place where there were lots and lots and lots of individual landowners in small holdings mostly, and all of them had a nice new house and they were paying less for it than they'd been paying before. So they completely transformed, these Irish MPs, completely transformed the face of Ireland, mostly Southern Ireland. And they led the way, really, for the really first big kick in the teeth that the British Empire got, which was from the Irish, of course. That's the sort of thing that would be interesting to see today. Another thing which I've been looking into, particularly, was a controversy at the end of the Second World War. What happened to the Nazi loot? Now, they went all over Europe, and particularly towards the end of World War II, after D-Day, they were very specific about getting anything that was in the least bit valuable and taking it back to Berlin. So, where did it all go? Does anyone like to help us out here? Oh, right, this is, okay, possibly. Swiss banks, yeah, you said, anyone else? Okay, the most important thing to understand about all this is that there was one man who had control of this Nazi money. Yes, I think probably the closest was talking about Switzerland. The Swiss were appalling, and I would say still are, in being, playing war. I mean, isn't it a weird country, Switzerland? I mean, for those of us who've been there, Zurich, it's a kind of soulless place. Everything works very efficiently, but there's no one talks to each other on the bus. And it's just a bit weird. Now, they have world wars raging around them, and they must stand on their mountains and watch, oh, there's everyone fighting over there, look, all those tanks and everything. But they're sitting there raking it in, effectively. I mean, there was a story last week in several of the newspapers about Montagu Norman. He was in charge of the Bank of England during World War II, being a Nazi sympathiser. Hang on a minute. We're supposed to be fighting a war against Hitler, Montagu, and there you are giving him special credits through Swiss banks. What are you up to? You're supposed to be the governor of the Bank of England, Montagu Norman. Anyway, the key figure with the Nazi loot is this guy Martin Bormann. There are many pictures of him around. He wasn't very well known during the war, but he was Hitler's secretary. Now, the way Hitler used to run things, as many of you know, is he would have two people in most roles. So he would have those two people both competing for his affections and trying to outdo the other one. There are some managers I've worked for over the years who seem to have a similar kind of attitude to their staff, where they're always trying to get them vying for their affections and attentions, you know, in this weird hierarchical way. But anyway, Hitler did this with Martin Bormann and Rudolf Hess. Rudolf Hess and Bormann were both in a very similar sort of position. Hess then went on that aeroplane flight, if people remember about this stuff, up to Scotland to meet with the Duke of Argyll to try and organise a peace, supposedly, because Hitler was about to attack Russia, or the Soviet Union. And the idea was, Hess can make a deal with Churchill, and then he'll come in the war on the side of the Nazis against the Russians. Well, this was never really going to happen. But anyway, it meant that Hess was out of the way. So from that point on in 1941, the Bormann had Hitler's full attention. And at the end of the Second World War, there were a lot of stories around, oh, we found Bormann's body, blah, 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 we found Bormann's body. Well, sorry, but he made it away to South America. And there are two really interesting books, one of which is by a guy called Paul Manning. And I, you know, reading these things, you look through this and you think, hang on, why haven't we been told all this? Now, that Paul Manning was not just anybody. He was a CBS News' correspondent in Europe for America during World War II. He was the guy who was sitting in the Flying Fortresses and the Lancaster Bombers, radioing back to America to tell them what was going on in Europe, right? After the war, in the 1980s, he wrote a book called Martin Bormann, Nazi in Exile, because he'd come across loads of evidence that, you know, many of us know that many of these Nazis went to South America, but Martin Bormann, there was loads of evidence of him. In fact, there is his signature on loads of documents that Paul Manning had got hold of. And it turned out that Bormann had set up 750 corporations, mostly in neutral countries after the war, but some here in Britain after a few years, in the 1940s and 1950s. And he was investing all this looted money. It was going through this Sullivan and Cromwell's law firm in New York, which was Alan Dulles's law firm. He was the guy that set up the CIA. And the backdrop to this, of course, is you've got the CIA, and actually the British as well, welcoming a lot of SS people, a lot of Nazis, because they wanted them to help them fight the Cold War. So, you know, in order to fight the Russians, we need all this expertise from former Nazi Germany. So they're laundering all this money through Sullivan and Cromwell's law firm, investing it in these new companies, 750 companies that Bormann's created. And guess who they use as the directors of these companies? Former SS people. So they take off their SS uniforms and they go into the boardroom, and then off they go out into the world with these very powerful corporations, all financed by laundered money that the Nazis looted in World War II. So, fascinating book by Paul Manning. But then there's another story that goes with that, and that is this thing called Op JB. Now, Ian Fleming, hang on, it's just my little list here. I think make sure I get everybody in there. It's Ian Fleming, who everyone knows as the guy that wrote the James Bond books, and then retired out to Jamaica to GoldenEye. Then also Desmond Morton, who was one of the top people in MI6 during World War II, as well as King George VI and Churchill. The four of them set up this little unit to go and nab Bormann. So the British actually got him out just before the Russians arrived in Berlin. And then he was secreted over to South America. Now, the story that the soldiers that went and did that were told was, oh, we want to get our hands on this Nazi money so we can distribute it after the war, because we know the Russians won't do that. They'll just take it for themselves. So these soldiers were all sold this story. Then they brought Bormann back. And, of course, then Bormann was squirreled away and disappeared, and they didn't see any more of him. And one of the people who was on that mission, a guy called John Ainsworth Davis, was only 21 and he led the mission. He's still alive and he's written a book. This is called Investigative Journalism, folks. He's written a book called Op JB, Operation James Bond. Now, the actual operation itself in the war was called Operation James Bond. So I think, I mean, didn't need to be a genius to work this out, but one of the reasons Ian Fleming named his fictional character James Bond was to put little clues in there for us, as to say, well, where did he get this name from? Who is James Bond? Where did he come from? So Fleming was involved in that from Naval Intelligence, as well as all these other people. And the whole thing was kept totally secret. Now, to what extent, Churchill and the higher-ups knew what was going to happen to all this money, God only knows. But it certainly makes a lot of sense to me when I see what's happening in the world today. I mean, back in World War II, at least Hitler, when he invaded your country, he sent panzer tanks in and he was very obvious about it. You know, here I come, I'm Adolf Hitler. Nowadays, I think what's going on is you've got a banking and a financial army that are taking over by other means, aren't they? They're taking over by buying up things. They're taking over by saying, oh, I'm sorry, your hospital's got to be closed down. It's being taken over by this private healthcare firm. Now, at the I'm not saying necessarily the individuals involved in that are Nazis and would wear swastikas, but they certainly have been picked by people who are very, very ruthless in the way they deal with things. I don't know if anyone noticed when Cadbury's were taken over by Kraft, for example. They were just utterly ruthless. You know, they told us in Bristol that the cane sugar factory was going to remain open, and then when the deal was finally done, as soon as it was done, the factory was closed. I mean, it is like a financial war I see going on at the moment. With and if you combine what I was saying earlier on about the criminal city of London and the absolute impunity, so these people can commit crimes knowing the police won't knock on their door, neither will any investigative journalists knock on their door and do an investigation and put it on the telly or probably in the newspapers either. So there's that culture of impunity around now. Very dangerous situation to be in. But all is not totally lost, of course, as ever. In the world of hobbits, there are other hobbits who are doing investigative journalism too. And so this is just out. This is by Adam Libor, who's an English guy who lives in Hungary, who I got an interview with a few weeks ago, just before the week before the book came out, actually. The Tower of Basel, and this is back to your Swiss banks again, the shadowy history of the secret bank that runs the world. Now, it sounds like a novel, but it isn't. It's a factual account of this bank called the Bank for International Settlements. And does anybody know a famous figure on the British scene who's on the board of the Bank for International Settlements? Mark Carney. Our new governor of the Bank of England is also on the board of the Bank for International Settlements. Now, this bank, it was set up after World War I. Oh, no, you were going to ask me, where did it come from? Yeah, it was set up after World War I to administer the war reparations, because the conference at the end of World War I, it was decided that Germany was going to have to pay back all of the pain that it created in the war. And BIS, by the 1930s, was actually funding Hitler. And right through the war, it was offering him foreign exchange as well. So if he wanted to change money into foreign currencies, he could do it through BIS. No questions asked. So after the war, at the Bretton Woods Conference, the Americans, and not the British, because Montague Norman just kept mum, he didn't say anything from Bank of England, the Americans tried to get the bank closed down. In fact, they put a resolution to the Bretton Woods Conference asking for the bank to be closed. And they voted on it at the Bretton Woods Conference, which set up the IMF and the World Bank and all those things. And they voted for it, and it was closed. Supposedly, it was voted to be closed, but it never was closed. It's still there. In fact, up until the 1970s or early 80s, the BIS, Mark's bank, it was an anonymous door next to a chocolate shop opposite Basel railway station. So it didn't even have a sign on the door saying this is the Bank for International Settlements. I'm not sure if their bankers from around the world were getting lost trying to find it, but. Back in the early 80s, they built this thing that you can see on the front there, the Tower of Basel, they call it, which is the headquarters of the Bank for International Settlements. Mark Carney is not just on the board of this bank, he's also on the two most crucial committees. One is the policy-making committee for central banks around the world, and the other is the regulation committee for central banks around the world. So he's not only on the board of the bank, he's also regulating and supposedly regulating himself and other central banks, but also making policy for those banks. Now, they meet every 2 months, a representative from every, or the boss of every central bank in the Western world meets up in Switzerland, and the meetings are totally secret. So if you want to read a decent investigative work, they do still exist, and Adam's done a fantastic job on that, getting that out, to explain that actually Carney is not, he's on the board of a bank which funded Hitler, which was supposed to be closed down, which wasn't, and secondly, he is right in the middle of this global financial crisis. Now, if you think about it, he's been doing policy and regulation. Well, what's gone so wrong since 2008 and in the run-up to 2008 is policy and regulation. So Mark Carney's been right in the middle of creating this mess, which is a mess for us, but for the 1,000 richest people in Britain, it's not been a mess at all. It was the Sunday Times statistics read out by Michael Meacher. He's explained that the 1,000 richest people in Britain are now £140 million each better off than they were before 2008. So think about that for a minute. It's not a crisis for them. Yeah, so that's where real politics lies and the real power lies, and I hope that the Green Party recognises that actually Westminster, all the time these bankers are in charge, is just a bit of a charade and a theatre where you can have a kind of Punch and Judy show with one person having a go at another person. But until you actually get to grips with the banking system in the Western world, whether it's the euro or whoever else it is, you're never going to sort anything out, because you're always going to be having to go cap in hand to those bankers and ask them for some more money. Until you grasp the nettle, bite the bullet, and take control of the system of the money, the Treasury should be running the money system, not the banks. We've just heard, haven't we, last week, Royal Bank of Scotland is going to be floated back on the stock exchange. They're going to. Are we going to get all our money back? Well, I doubt it very much. But the government, if the government wants to run the country, it needs to control the money. And it's not doing that. It's not even been using its shareholding in RBS and Lloyds to force them to lend to people. They just say, oh, well, we can't, can we? And they're being very curmudgeonly. And actually, these bankers are in charge. Another good bit of investigative journalism is this. Now, I don't know if people have come across John Morgan, but this is a great little book. And what he's done is he's published, John, he's a Republican from Australia. He's an investigative journalist, retired, but he's come out of retirement to do the book. He's actually quite ill. But The Assassination of Princess Diana, The Paris-London Connection. Now, what he's done in here, and it's only about a 130-page book, it's really easy to read, is he's pulled apart the police inquiries in France and the police inquiries here and all the evidence given at the inquest into Diana's death. And he's actually pinned down some dates. If I can find it. Maybe the date itself isn't so important, but he's pinned down. There was something when Diana and Charles agreed to divorce. There was a whole organisation set up within the royal household called the Way Ahead Group, and this was a sort of PR speak for how are we going to deal with Diana. And though this group met every 6 months or so, considering various different problems to do with the problems Diana was causing. And in 1997 they met, and he has actually pinned down specific people who were at a meeting where it looks as if it was decided, right, we're going to have to actually just get rid of her. And there's a guy called Sherard Cowper-Coles, was drafted over from MI6, over to Paris, the weekend before the accident. And this guy, Sherard Cowper-Coles, it looks, was the guy who's in charge of actually just bumping off Diana. It may have been that they phoned up the station chief in Paris and said, well, can you arrange this operation? And the guy said no, whoever was in charge. But anyway, Sherard Cowper-Coles was up for it. And he's pinned down this specific person. And incidentally, he was not long after Diana died. He was given a knighthood. As the person who actually arranged Diana's murder. And this is all a little bit strange, isn't it? Why should they want to, you know, and for many people, they look at the royals and say, well, they're a bit flaky anyway. Who cares about Diana anymore? Actually, for anyone that ever met Diana, as I had the privilege to once, you could see that it was like her and Charles were like chalk and cheese. She was a very ordinary person. She's the sort of person who'd sit down here and have a chat with us. She was very open and honest, and you could see that she was a completely different person. And one thing I will tell you about why I think the royal family disliked her so much was that she had access to the press. And one of the things I was working for the BBC down in Salisbury when they had a big concert, and Charles and Diana supposedly arrived in a helicopter, and Charles got out of the helicopter, no sign of Diana, and all the crowd are looking to each other, oh, where's Diana gone, oh, she's disappeared, she's not here. And after about 10 minutes of Charles going, shaking hands of people through the crowd, suddenly Diana stepped out into the doorway of the helicopter, and someone spotted her. They go, "Oh, it's Diana! Diana's here!" People just loved her. And everybody in that whole place was pointing at and looking at Diana, and not a single person was interested in Charles. And he turned around to look at Diana, and if looks could kill. So there was a real massive animosity there. And Diana was stealing the limelight, basically. And so I think that's one of the reasons she was assassinated. I don't know if there's anyone here that thinks that it was just an accident. I mean, certainly the evidence is, if you look at the book, you'll see that she was almost entirely uninjured by the crash. So why should she die in the ambulance on the way to the hospital? All sorts of reasons to suspect what happened there. The other thing, of course, was that the photographers and the paparazzi were quite clearly set up. So if we can't have a panorama about that, you know, if people can get away with that sort of crime and it's not investigated properly, we're living in a world which is a slightly... it's almost like it psychopathic from the top down. You know, we're talking about a leadership that have completely lost any interest in ordinary people at all, and that all they're interested in doing is getting people who they see as a safe pair of hands, like Sherrard Cowper-Coles, and giving them knighthoods and giving them power and responsibility, because they know that because they're a criminal, that they won't talk, or they won't basically betray this little criminal gang that's running the country. Sherrard Cowper-Coles, by the way, now works for BAE Systems, Britain's biggest arms manufacturer. He got a job straight from MI6, straight working for them, and he was a participant at the recent Bilderberg conference in Watford. So he is now in with this sort of elite inner circle of people. So that's just one example of how that sort of thing goes on. I will say, just before I finish, because I'm quite aware people might want to ask some questions and give some thoughts of their own little conspiracies or bits of investigative journalism that need doing, is this organisation, the Bilderberg Conference. I mean, I started, when I came out of the BBC, I was working for the Land Is Ours and just doing this thing of, as a voluntary work, organising land occupations. We took over various places. One place was in Wandsworth in London. It was called Pure Genius. And I was sitting in the office for about 3 or 4 months beforehand, organising, you know, getting coaches ready to go. It was great fun. We all turned out on a Saturday at Easter with about 4 or 5 coaches, with each one person from the Land Is Ours in each coach at the front, with a little map in a brown envelope that you could only open once the coach had started going. So none of us actually knew where we were going to be occupying the land, and we had about 250 people all took over this piece of land next to Wandsworth Bridge, which was owned by Guinness. The plan was that Guinness wanted to sell it as a supermarket and luxury flats. The local people were doing a little campaign against it, and we just thought, as an organisation, let's get behind the local campaign. So I think, in a way, that's what some of the most successful campaigns are, is where you've got a small group of dedicated people, and you can come in behind them with an army to give them the publicity and the support that they need. Really fantastic action it was, and we took over this piece of land and stayed there for around about 6 months. But while I was on there, someone came to me and said, "Well, this land, the land issue, and the injustice of land ownership is one thing, but what about money? And what about these Bilderbergs that control the world?" Well, no, they don't control the world, sorry. But anyway, I dutifully wrote down the name of the Bilderbergs. And I had access to the Reuters archive database someone had given me. And I found a whole load of interesting stuff that wasn't on the internet about the Bilderbergs. So I put it up on the internet. And within about 3 weeks, the service provider emailed me saying, "We've had to close your website because you've had too many hits." So I thought, well, this is interesting. And I started looking a little bit more at this group. And you look through the list of the Bilderberg Conference, and you see that these are the people that control most of the money in the Western world. And I'm amazed that I didn't even... annoyed, actually, that I didn't even know about these people. Anyway, thankfully, more people do know about the Bilderbergs now. And, you know, a million people here, I'm sure, have heard. Can I just have... we have a show of hands. How many people know about the Bilderbergs? Yes! There's almost half, roughly. But that's what we need. We need more awareness of who is really running things, because clearly it's not being run by Westminster. What is their agenda at the Bilderberg Conference? Well, interesting. I mean, I find it fascinating. You've got royalty there. You've got all these top bankers. We had something like 4, maybe 3 executives from HSBC there, the money launderers. It's a kind of Bond villains get together, isn't it? I mean, you look at these, some of these characters, they look incredibly shifty. Then with Shirley Williams as well. What is Shirley Williams doing with all these Bond villains? Now, if you look at the continuities, getting back to what I was saying about Operation James Bond, Op JB, and the Christopher Crichton's book, John Ainsworth Davis's book about this operation in World War II, the connection there is you've got, for example, the Wallenberg family in Sweden, a very powerful banking family. They're talked about in Paul Manning's book about Martin Bormann and the post-war Nazi networks. The Wallenberg family had two brothers in the war, one of whom, both of whom were had separate businesses, one of whom was supporting, in Sweden, was supporting the Nazis, the other was supporting the Allies. And of course they did the same with big organisations like Royal Dutch Shell. They had two basically parallel, separate organisations, one of whom was supporting the Nazis and the other was supporting the Allies. And these people weren't stupid. They wanted to make sure whoever won the war, they weren't necessarily sure at that time, that they came out on top and that their business stayed in their hands. Now, the Wallenberg family, like I say, are talked about in Paul Manning's book as a way, one of the routes that Martin Bormann laundered this stolen money from World War II through Sweden. That same family is there at the Bilderberg conference. They're the main representatives from Sweden at the Bilderberg meeting. So I'll finish by saying I think that's what we're dealing with. We are dealing with Nazis who've taken off their swastikas, put on suits, and they've marched in to the financial world. And they're now taking over our governments, our hospitals, our schools. And unless we understand the kind of ruthless characters that we're dealing with, we'll never be able to actually see our way through this. Actually, where do we go from here? We obviously have to do, and it was lovely to see your leader, I'm not sure what her name is, who was on before me, Natalie, wearing her Diggers t-shirt, because I'm a massive fan of the Diggers from the English Civil War. But one thing people don't necessarily understand about the Diggers is that their manifesto that Gerard Rinstanley wrote after he'd become a Quaker during the Civil War, at the end of the Civil War, was the abolition of money. He didn't believe we needed money at all. And in fact, this is one of the things I can always remember from my student days, this anarchist student who he was standing to be the president of the Students' Union, and he didn't give a speech or anything, he just stood there with a £5 note and he burnt it in front of us all. Yeah. And you know what? He won. He won the vote. Abolition of money is actually essential. As a human society, we can deal with each other through trust and actually through directly things like bartering, this kind of thing. Certainly the way that money is organised could be done a lot better, not through private banking and people controlling, you know, controlling our money system for private interests, a little bit like the money changers in the temple that Jesus kicked out, those people. But we could have a much better money system. But actually, the Diggers were more radical than that. They were saying we've got to liberate the land, we've got to redistribute the land, as they've been doing, as they did in Ireland back in the 1880s, and as they've been doing in many places in South America more recently. But unless we do that, unless we abolish money, we're not going to really be able to see our way through to making a better future. Because that money is what the bad people need to keep their control. All it is something on a bank account, and they can only keep their control by impoverishing us. That is by taking away the basic things that poor people and disabled people need to live their lives. So that's my little vision for the future, is abolishing money and also redistributing land. But also we do need to have much better investigative journalism in this country. And I'd just like to say, well, thank you very much everyone for listening, and do your own little bits on the internet if you don't mind. So thanks for listening, everyone. Now, have we got the roving mics for questions? And if so, how much time have we got? So we don't want to run into the next. Anyone got any questions? Or would like to tell some stories they think people should hear? No?
Isn't part of the answer to this that we should start our own banks? Because money seems to be the whole key. They say money makes the world go round. It clearly doesn't go the right way.
Yeah, well, one of the basic problems is we've got away from the the fundamentals of money. Money should be there to serve us. It should be there to help oil the wheels of, you know, you exchanging one thing for another. One thing I heard about just within the last couple of weeks is that there's an Abrahamic bank being set up in London. Now, what that means is it's looking at the Abrahamic religions, the Jewish, Muslim, Christian religions, and taking their view of money, which is there should never be any interest paid on a loan. No usury, right? Usury used to be a crime in Britain. You know, if you charge interest on a loan, you know, then you'd be jailed. But, of course, now it's almost compulsory. So what they're trying to do with this bank that they're setting up in London is to basically franchise it out around the country. So people would be maybe more confident in putting their money in a safe bank like that rather than in somewhere like HSBC where they might get a bit more interest. So it's the idea is a sort of alternative to credit unions but run on a no-interest basis. So that, you know, as an initiative, someone has bit the bullet there, is doing something. When? Oh, God, well...
usury a crime in Britain, just approximately, just like 1800s, 1300s.
One thing I should say, these are really, I mean, this is a really important question, isn't it? When? Here is a fantastic little book which I picked up for £1 in a second-hand bookshop about probably 10 years ago, and it's called The Wordsworth Dictionary of British History, right? It's actually far better than any other British history book, and it's not just about Britain, it talks about the empire quite a lot and goes into detail about our crimes around the world. But it's written from a people's point of view, and so I can, if you want, look up when usury, because you're absolutely right. It's important. I mean, it used to be, a crime. You've got a question over the back there. While I'm looking it up, do you want to?
First of all, when you say that usury was a crime, yeah, I mean, it depends. Charging interest wasn't a crime. It was charging interest more than a certain rate. I'm kind of wondering if fact's not correct. How many of your others aren't correct? Are there any kind of conventionally known conspiracy theories which you don't regard as conspiracy theories? I do accept a lot of truth, a lot of what you say. I certainly haven't swallowed it all yet.
Right, it's a section. Shall I just address your question about other things which I might say? Please don't believe me. Yeah? Don't believe me. Yeah, I'm not. Hopefully, I don't come across as a sort of patronising person who say, "Well, I know everything." You know, no, it's not like that at all. The fact of the matter is, we're living in a world flooded with disinformation. The idea being to just basically switch us off from engaging in international and national debates. And the fact of the matter is, I did explain earlier on. There's a really good book, I think, a really good book called Secrets and Lies by David Southwell, which does actually blow by blow go down. And I would suggest, if you want a much more entertaining talk than mine, you get David along to a future Green Gathering, because he is incredibly good. I mean, he for example worked as a public relations guy with Tony Blair, closely with him, you know, and so he's able to sort of tell you just exactly how this kind of stuff worked on the inside. For example, how Nestle make sure that their policies get through by saying to Tony Blair, he's got a Kit Kat in his hand, he holds out, "Do you know what this is, Tony Blair?" And Tony Blair's looking at this Kit Kat, you know, and he wonders, this is a trick question, do I say this is a Kit Kat, you know? And this guy from Nestle then says, "No, this is the product that if you enforce these new laws will never be made in your country again, so you better not enforce those new laws, Tony." Yeah, so David's been in right in the middle of all a lot of this stuff, and he's done that job. And I would say, don't believe him either. Yeah, have a look at it for yourself. Everybody's got to really make up their own mind about these things. All I'm there to do as a journalist is to at least hopefully point people in the right direction. And as I said right at the very start, it's a hell of a responsibility. When you sit down and start writing something, you think to yourself, crikey, I better get this right. And so I do my best. That's all I can do. Anyway. Back to usury. My eyesight isn't so good, but anyway, the charging of interest on a loan of money forbidden by medieval canon law. There you go. After medieval times, I would say, it was when it became punishable in the courts. Interest on loans such as those made by Italian bankers to the crown in the late 13th and 14th century was paid in other forms, in annuities until legally permitted in the 16th century. So it's slowly over the years, it's been allowed a little bit more and then to get into using interest. Now we're in a situation where we have a benefit cap in Britain of 1%. So what happens when inflation goes up to 15%? You're just literally going to have people cast out of their homes, begging on the street and living in ditches. You know, we don't really want to live like that, thank you very much. And that's one of the reasons I've pointed right the way through my talk to the City of London as one of the most criminal gangs in the country. In fact, there was Duncan McLaughlin, a very good book called The Filth. He worked for Metropolitan Police Drug Squad and Fraud Squad. And Duncan said that the drug squad, even when he was working for them, were the best organised criminal gang in Britain. The drug squad. Okay, any more questions, points? Yeah?
Triodos Bank, have you got any?
Well, I've got a personal story about Triodos Bank, because we set up something in Bristol called the Eco Village Network. We got an account with Triodos Bank. Great, fantastic. Only a little bit of money going through it. But then I set up this as a stall around the corner with some of our videos, Culture Shop, with a few other people who've been meeting up, journalists, video journalists mostly, and people like Paul from Undercurrents. And we set up a little thing called cultureshop.org, which was selling DVDs online. So people all over the world can buy the Battle of the Beanfield DVD, these sorts of obscure DVDs. I went to Triodos with that, and over the space of about 4 months and several meetings with them, they eventually said, no, this isn't the sort of project we want to support. Now, what are you doing, you know? So they're a little bit flaky too, you know.
I think they're a bit conservative then on their projects that they like to pick and choose.
I think, look, my own view is that the co-op were actually quite good, but as a bank, but that they've been now torpedoed by HSBC and by other people, by people conning them into going into this deal with the Britannia Building Society. They've been conned. I mean, if you go back something like 7 or 8 years, there was a news story just blipped quickly about the Co-op Bank being infiltrated. Yeah, the board of the Co-op Bank, they had somebody on the board who was actually spying on them and working for somebody else. So this kind of financial warfare is going on in our major high street banks. And the big nasty guys like HSBC, all they want to do is they want to, you know, torpedo or smash or whatever, rocket-propelled grenade into the co-op, because they don't want them around. Any of the really ethical banks are going to be taken out. Like, I mean, who knows with Triodos? I mean, I don't know what the real ethics are of the people that run it. It seems to be quite a good bank, you know.
It's based on Steiner principles.
But Steiner, you know, there's the good side of the Steiner and there's the bad side of the Steiner.
Yeah,
you know?
No, but I'm just saying it's supposed to be loosely based on his theories of economics, isn't it? That's one of the things that.
Yeah, the trouble is that you can take anything, can't you? Which is a great principle, and then you can turn it to rubbish by actually using that as a front. You know, this is the trouble. He's always trying to see through that front to what is really going on behind the scenes. Often you'll find you can't actually get access to the real individuals who are running it. If you can, that's a good an indication that maybe that they are a reasonably honest bank. Another one?
A quote that I heard from John Pilger was, there is no such thing as a conspiracy. It's just the way things are. So long as you chase conspiracy theories, they'll have you running around with rabbit warrens full of lies and fibs and deceit. The reason why it's the way things are is because you don't need to conspire if you simply follow corporate ethics. You don't need to talk to each other. Therefore, we need to rip up the book of corporate ethics. A second point, you'll think this is going in the wrong direction and being a bit bizarre, but did you know in the Bible, in Matthew, when Jesus is on trial, they say, who would you want to let go, Barabbas or Jesus? And they say, let Barabbas go. Barabbas was guilty of being a revolutionary, and he was guilty of sedition against the Romans. He was a good guy. Does anybody here know Barabbas' first name? It was Jesus. So they said, who would you want to let go? The Jesus that does something, the Jesus that's a revolutionary, or the Jesus that said his prayers. And if you think that's not right, check your Bible. Jesus Barabbas. So let him be in your hearts. Don't say prayers. Do something. He was a revolutionary.
Well, I think both. You know, I think it's, you know, from a spiritual point of view, you know, I think it's important to do both. And as a writer, I think it's also important that I'm actually not prepared to just write, but actually to go and act. I mean, if I was just prepared to, you know, to, for example, with the census. I mean, people remember that a couple of years ago, where one of those big, massive American arms firms was behind the census. I made it quite public on the radio, oh, I'm not going to do the census, you know? So, I mean, maybe that's just not acting, but to actually carry your pontifications out into the real world, I think, is also very important. And this is one of the reasons that I'm a big follower of the diggers, because they weren't just sitting talking about land reform. They actually would go out and occupy land. I'm also a very big supporter of squatting and squatters. I think, you know, we've got a crazy situation now with literally a boom in empty buildings, you know? So squatting should be booming, but that's why Ken Clark, Bilderberg, has brought in this new thing about criminalising squatting. How can you criminalise homelessness? What an appalling thing to do. Morally bankrupt, totally morally bankrupt. And these are actually a tiny number of people at the top that are making all these decisions. We're not living in a democracy. Does anyone think we are? No, of course we're not. Okay, any more questions? Or points?
The other religion?
Yeah, I'm Quaker, yeah.
Well, how do you justify that?
How do I justify it?
Yeah.
Why should I justify it?
What do Quakers do for plot?
Well, I'm talking about the spiritual side of what I do. I have a very much a practical world outside that as well.
Is that not dogmatic though?
Yeah, probably.
Dogma spelled backwards, I'm God.
It probably is dogmatic to be a Quaker. I'm not sure. But all we do is we sit around in silence as Quakers, and we speak sometimes. You know, sometimes you have an entire hour's meeting where nobody says anything. Other times, the idea being that it's not part of some sort of organised religion where some vicar is telling you what to think. Well, it's not. It's very much bottom up. It's the opposite to an organised religion.
Organising within a Quaker meeting, you're in it for 3 years and then you evolve. All the positions you held for 3 years, then they revolve. So, you know, I might be Clark, I might be leading this meeting this year, but next year it might be you. And they meet that of God within everybody. It's not, it
My
is
God,
with
what happened to Goddess.
You can be a Buddhist and you can be a Quaker, you can believe in Goddess. I don't believe in God, but I do believe I'm a Quaker.
It's a farce, it's a monotheistic bullshit.
You don't
Look,
have to love
excuse
it.
Me, excuse me, excuse me. Yeah, this is
religion.
Not a very nice way to end. Yeah?
Yeah.
So can I just say thank you for being a really lovely audience and for listening. And we've got the Welsh Green Party, someone called Pippa, coming on next. So thanks very much for being patient and all the questions. Cheers.
Hello, if everyone wants to stay, the next speaker is going to be Pippa, who's the leader of the Welsh Green Party.
Thank you very much. Thank you. If you want to go, if you want to stay, it's up to you. Yeah, I'm leader of the Green Party in Wales. As many of you might know. Can you all hear me properly, by the way, because I'm a bit tall? Is that better? Yeah? Hang on. That's probably it. Okay. So Wales is partly devolved. Some say not devolved enough. Some say far too devolved. And I want to explore that a bit. So I'm really going to come at this from a Welsh proposition point of view. I'm sure you've heard from Natalie earlier today about the sort of English stance of the Green Party. And unfortunately, I missed her, so I hope I'm not doubling up on anything she said. But first of all, hi to everybody. I'm going to talk a little bit. I'm going to talk a little bit about the E word, okay, the economy. We talked about monetary reform just now, and I'd like to follow it up a little bit because, do you know, there are a lot of groups working on monetary reform, and they're very badly attended. If you go to the Positive Money website, you'll find enormous amounts of information.